week of this course, and the first week we had actually aimed all the sessions of this course on the various I would say components of research and how to carry out research in an effective manner in the present times. I hope my participants have maximized their learning during the first week. This week we are going to concentrate on the Moodle learning management system, which is one of the world's leading learning management system. So starting with Moodle, today our first session we have amongst us our invited speaker, Ms. Tanya Garg. Ms. Tanya Garg is working as an assistant professor with Bharti Vidya Peeth Institute of Computer Applications and Management. A software expert, she is a member of the Moodle Customization and Management Committee. She is also the training head at BVI Camp, as well as the SCDC cell in charge. So I welcome Tanya ma'am amongst us today, and I'll request ma'am now to start with the introductory session on Moodle. So thank you so much, ma'am. Kindly start with your session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for the warm welcome. So, a very good afternoon, dear participants. I welcome you all on the second week of this ongoing refresher course. And this week, we'll be focusing on the hands-on implementation of the world's most popular learning management system, as ma'am said, that is Moodle. Moodle as an LMS, we'll be seeing its implementation, its usage, how we can fit it into our scenario, and how we can derive the maximum benefits out of its features available. So I welcome you all to this ongoing workshop, and especially the second week on Moodle hands-on training. In this week-long interaction, we will be covering the basic concepts of Moodle in concept delivery, followed by a practical demonstration in every session. So the plan is laid out in such a way that beginning from today, right here, henceforth, the first session I'll be concentrating on only the basic features of Moodle. I'll be telling you theoretically how it is as advanced as a learning management system and how it is different from its other variants. What are the features available in Moodle that can be used in the blended e-learning model? That is not just physical interaction, but now everything moving to the virtual space, how to carry out the synchronous and asynchronous blend of learning, classroom teaching and offline teaching beyond the class, virtual class, using a learning management system like Moodle. So I'll be detailing in this session just the theoretical aspect to you, but second session onwards, the second session which begins at 4 p.m. today, we will be doing a practical hands-on training. So certain links have been provided to you for download of some packages, and then there is an installation process. So don't worry if you are completely technologically averse or you don't know anything as to how to download those packages or how to carry out the session, because we'll be detailing it step by step in the session beginning from 4 p.m. onwards. So we'll be first of all making you install a Moodle on-premise implementation. Moodle and its variants is available in two flavors. Let me mention that in the beginning, first of all. One is an on-premise implementation and another is a cloud-based implementation. So when I say it's an on-premise implementation, I mean that you will be setting up actual Moodle servers on your laptops or your workstations. So that is why it is advisable that most of you either work with us using your laptops during the session or probably later on catch up using the YouTube tutorial and then implement the solution on your laptop, because that way you can derive the maximum benefits out of the practical sessions. Now, there is a second variant of Moodle which is available on the cloud, which we also call as a cloud version or off-premise version. It is available in flavors like Moodle Cloud, Genomio. There are many service providers which provide for the Moodle Cloud version also. So we'll be giving you a brief about what that cloud-based implementation is. You can think of it to be very similar to a Google Classroom implementation. So Google Classroom is one LMS which is completely on cloud. It's a cloud-based LMS. So you just go onto the Google Classroom site, you create your account or probably use your existing Gmail credentials, and just start with creating classes and uploading materials. So similar sort of an implementation is also available with Moodle. That's called the cloud-based implementation. So we'll be giving you a brief of that, but the main purpose of this week-long interaction is that we need you to have your on-premise installations. We'll be teaching you how to set that up, how to create Moodle servers, and how to further on work with an on-premise version. The basic advantage of a on-premise installation, apart from that of cloud, is that in an on-premise implementation, you have complete control over all your data and your security measures are completely in-premise. So if I have a Moodle server on my laptop or on one of the workstations of my college or system like that, then all the data that I want to upload on Moodle or all the settings, all the installation nitty-gritties which I want are there on my within premise. I'm not dependent on any cloud server for that. And it's a completely open source, free of cost installation. There is no cost associated with an on-premise installation. But when you take that installation to a cloud-based offering, then there are certain packages and costs involved at certain features at certain point in time. You can also think of it to be compliant to certain services provided by the cloud. So if I'm a cloud service provider and I'm giving you a Moodle on cloud implementation where you're just coming in and creating your account and I'm taking care of all installation, backups, recoveries, everything, then for all the services that I'm providing you and all the data that I'm handling, I will be handling your data. So your data will not be on your premise. It will be on my servers. So I will be associating certain cost with it. So that is a certain sort of an advantage or a disadvantage, you can say, from both perspectives. It's cost-based in a cloud implementation, but at the same time, all your technical nitty-gritties are taken care of by the cloud service provider. So you never really need to bother how the Google Classroom was set up or where our data is stored. Whenever we go to a Google Class, our data is there. Whenever we want to access it, we can do it. So that kind of a relief is provided in an on-cloud implementation. So both implementations have their pros and cons. It is only up to us what suits best in our current scenario, that we take a decision we want to go in for a Moodle on-premise implementation or we want to go in for a cloud-based offering. So that decision lies solely with the person who's implementing it. So there is no right and wrong here. It's just perspective-based and requirement-based. What suits your best case? So in this week-long interaction, we'll be telling you how to set up Moodle on your own servers, how to create a Moodle server, how to create your own Moodle site. And then we'll be talking of certain features and customizations that Moodle offers. User creation, different user roles in Moodle. Then we'll be talking of how to create courses and categories, how to add resources, activities, and data into those courses, how to conduct examinations, one of the most critical component of the virtual environment, conducting safe browser examinations, conducting examinations online, creating MCQs, tests. We'll be taking up all those aspects later on detailed as per plan in this week. So let's proceed. And in the best interest of all, I'll request all of you to please keep yourself on mute during the entire course of the session. If you have any queries coming up while the trainer is demonstrating a concept, I'll request you to please write that down in the chat box. We have our chat windows open with us. And also simultaneously, we'll be taking up queries in between the session also. So I'll be inviting doubts. I'll be asking you to turn on your mic and ask me questions that in the due course of the session. But for the best interest, let's keep our microphones on mute in the beginning. So let's proceed. So that is the basic layout which I discussed with the 1 week implementation of Moodle LMS in this workshop. It's a hands-on training. So when we say it's a hands-on training, the concepts as such are not very technically advanced or something where you need to do a lot of technical detailing. It is just that small details, basic details need to be implemented through a practical version. And when I say it's a practical training, we'll be teaching you on our own Moodle implementations. We'll be firstly making you install Moodle, implement your own site, and then we'll be teaching on that site. So if you just probably listen to us theoretically, that is a good to know, but later on when you'll be going to implement those things, probably you come up with some doubts or, you know, some technical problems, some installation issues, some requirement problems. So that will be a little difficult when you do it on your own. So best advice is that you work with us within this 1 week on the Moodle implementation. Then I said it's an on-premise implementation. I gave you a basic brief of what an on-premise and what a cloud-based offering is. For a even more deeper understanding in layman terms, you can think of it as, when I talk of an on-premise installation, I'm asking you to buy your own house. So when you buy your own house, you take care of all the fittings, all the requirements, all the household needs on your own. You are responsible for everything. You're responsible for the maintenance of the house, you're responsible for paying up bills, everything like that. So that is an on-premise installation where you have a lot of control. But with that control comes in a lot of responsibility. You need to take care of certain technical components. But when I talk of a cloud-based offering, think of it as renting a space, renting a house in some location. So when I rent a room, or probably if I rent a house also, complete accommodation, which belongs to somebody else, then I don't need to take care of everything. Many things will be taken care by the landlord, and I just need to go and customize my own space. Here I lack control. Here all my data is present in someone else's premise. But there are certain release that I get in terms of technical implementations. So that is the basic difference in the layman terminology, which I can talk about if I say a cloud-based offering or an on-premise offering. Next is, we'll be developing our Moodle sites. So now, not all of us belong to the same department or are working on the same field. So many of us will have different requirements. Some of us want to take up just classes online. Some of us want to even, you know, upload resources or certain study material. Some of us want to conduct examinations. So use case for every participant in this session, in this course, will be different. So we'll be talking of all possibilities which are available with a learning management system like Moodle, and out of which you can derive the best suited for yourself. So I'm not propagating that this is the best learning management system available for you. I am just going to tell you the basic features which are available with Moodle and what all you can do with it. Towards the end of this week, on the sixth day, I will myself be comparing Moodle to another learning management system like Google Classroom, which is very prevalent and I'll say very easy to use. Using a Google Classroom is very, very convenient. So I'll be detailing what a Google Classroom can do, what are the pros and cons, what are the cost-based solutions available in Google Classroom, and how further you can implement various concepts like mind maps or even functionalities like exam.net. Exam.net is a very popular examination site for conducting online examinations. So I'll be detailing all those solutions and comparing it to Moodle on the sixth day of this training, that is on Saturday. So for the first 1 week, we'll be doing an on-premise installation. And on the last day, I'll be just giving you a flavor of what other variants are available when we talk of the blended teaching learning model. So the plan. Next, based on the basic training, teaching learning purpose, the basic academic solution that we have right now at hand, we'll be talking of what teaching learning operations are available and how can they be emulated on a learning management system like Moodle. So since we all know, since the advent of COVID-19, everything has moved online. And the worst impacted sector here is education, that is academics. So in academics, earlier to take up classes, everything used to be in physical mode. Now how all those processes, right from taking class to examination, to uploading resources, creating activities, engaging students, and creating a more closely connected virtual environment or a learning space for a student, what operations are available with us, that we'll be discussing in the due course of this training. Then the basic layout of the training is that, apart from this session that I'm giving you, next session onwards, every trainer, along with myself, I have two more of my colleagues, Dr. Sunil Pratap Singh and Mr. Uttam Singh Bisht, we will be taking up sessions in this 1 week. And first of all, we begin with the basic theoretical concept of what is it in Moodle, how are resources created, how are users created, what are activities, and then we'll be practically demonstrating it to you in the session. We'll be doing that practically on our systems and demonstrating it to you, wherein we expect you to work with us on those solutions on your own on-premise implementations. Then, if you find any problems there, or if you're not able to complete any particular step, or if you have any more queries, you're thinking of extension points, we can always discuss that in session. So it is going to be a very interactive 1 week. We'll be expecting you to work with us and coming up with your own use cases and how to implement those things. That is the basic structure of this workshop that in this due course of 1 week we'll be taking up. So let's begin. So now Moodle is a basic learning management system. So before beginning, we need to first understand what an LMS is. So an LMS is actually a software implementation, or it's a virtual environment for all teaching learning processes. It's a software emulation of all the processes you take up, beginning from administration, documentation, tracking, reporting and automation in the delivery of knowledge within educational courses, trainings, or any such similar kind of an area. I want to get my entire classroom online. I want to conduct all activities that I used to do in my campus in a virtual space because now there are restrictions. So earlier this was a choice as to whether or not you want to have a virtual emulation of the concept that you're teaching or of the operations that you're doing. But now it is the need of the hour. You have to emulate everything that you are doing earlier on a physical space now to a virtual space. So Moodle is the world's most popular learning management system. But apart from Moodle, there are certain other variants available with us, like we have Canvas, Blackboard, Google Classroom, which are certain other flavors of a learning management system. Now, the basic aim of a learning management system is to convert the concept of e-learning to a more blended e-learning model. When I say blended, what am I blending here? I'm blending basically the synchronous and asynchronous learning mechanisms. When I talk of synchronous learning, I mean both the stakeholders, the teacher, the facilitator, as well as the student or the learner, need to be present simultaneously in the same virtual space. I'm talking of conducting classes. So when you and your student are present in the same physical space, earlier you used to conduct a class on premise. But now when you and your student are present at the same time in front of a machine connected through a video conferencing, you may do it on Google Meet, you may do it on Zoom, you may do it on Microsoft Teams. You are actually in a synchronous learning mode. Both the parties, both the stakeholders are present on the same platform at the same time. So this is synchronous learning. This is a physical class emulated on a virtual space where both the stakeholders are present on the same platform at the same time. So this is the synchronous aspect of learning. Now there is also an asynchronous aspect of learning. Earlier, apart from the lectures that we used to give on premise, there used to be certain assignments. We used to give resource materials. We used to issue books to students. Certain resource materials, notes used to be provided. We used to ask them to submit us assignments or case studies. We used to even conduct examinations. So those all extended mechanisms of teaching beyond the classroom, where a student goes home and further extends his synchronous learning with a teacher, came under the umbrella of asynchronous learning. So when I say I'm blending the synchronous and asynchronous learning mode, I need to get all this up firstly on a virtual space. I need a platform like software which emulates both these processes, and one software which emulates both these processes simultaneously is called a learning management system. So if we talk of synchronous learning mechanism, that can be achieved by certain video conferencing applications also. You can take up classes on Zoom. You might be taking classes on Microsoft Teams, but conduct examinations on Microsoft Teams. Can you ask students to submit assignments on Microsoft Teams? Right? So it is possible with certain variants. It is not possible with certain video conferencing variants, because that is the sole use case of those video conferencing variants. A video conferencing solution just needs you to provide a video conferencing mode. Two parties should communicate in a video conferencing call. That's it. But what about the later aspects or the other aspects, asynchronous aspects of teaching learning? These are emulated using a learning management system like Moodle or Google Classroom. So now with the advent of COVID-19, there have been a lot many updations in the past 6 months in Google Classroom. Being a Google product, there have been a lot of updates, one of which has been the integration of Google Meet with the Google Classroom. So if you are working with the Google Classroom, especially the G Suite variant, you will be getting an option to create a meeting link. So you can take up even classes using Google Meet, because it's a Google product, so it works with a Google umbrella of products. You can even take up classes using Google Meet, and as well as other perspectives of a Google Classroom, like submitting assignments, conducting quizzes, uploading PPTs, resource materials, all that is also possible. So Google Classroom is actually an LMS, which provides you the synchronous as well as asynchronous variants of teaching learning process. But when I talk of Moodle, Moodle is the world's most popular, or I'll say the world's most accepted learning management system, because it is completely open source and it has a lot many more features than Google Classroom, which we'll be witnessing in this due course of time. So let's move forward. I think specifically of Moodle, it's not a new concept. It's a concept that has been there since a time, invented first in 2002 by Martin Rogulis, and later on accepted by many countries in the world. It will surprise you to know that even India is a lot there, has been there using Moodle since a very long time before COVID-19. So it's a concept which has been there, it has been prevalent, and it has been accepted by people who want to extend the outreach of teaching learning, not just to in their own vicinity, not just to people who can physically come and attend their courses on campus, but throughout the globe. So it's a concept which was evaluated first in 2002 and gradually accepted later on. It's a leading virtual environment which enables you to create a private learning space completely online, full of engaging activities and materials for the learners. So the base feature or the most popular advantage with Moodle is that it's completely open source. You don't need to pay a single penny. Many of you must have downloaded the Moodle. So it's completely open source. It's free of cost. You can download Moodle, you can use it, and there will be no problem at all. You don't need to attach your card. You don't need to go into a 7-day free trial period or anything. There is no licensing cost involved with it. It's completely open source, free of cost. It is a blended learning model and distance education. Distance education in today's world is more so to the flavor of e-distance education. So earlier, distance education was where a learner physically used to commute to his learning space or college or campus and take up courses. But now distance education means online education. You don't even need to visit your campus once. There are many universities abroad post COVID-19 have opened up their courses completely online. So for which you earlier need to be present on campus or have a visa to attend those courses, now those courses are completely online and free of cost. So that model of distance education is also supported by Moodle. Then there is this concept of flipped classroom. Flipped classroom is actually reversing the teaching learning methodology from focus being on the facilitator to now shifting the focus on the learner. Earlier, it was a responsibility of the teacher to have the material, collect the resources, disseminate knowledge in the classroom, conduct activities, quizzes, conduct examinations, evaluate answer sheets. Now everything, the focus is being shifted to the learner. Teacher is just going to set up a Moodle site, set up an LMS, put in all her resources there. Take synchronous learning if at all required. In many institutions, like they support this concept of spoken tutorials also developed by IITs, right? So they don't even need synchronous learning mechanism. Everything is there on the Moodle site. Everything is there on the LMS. The student just needs to come learn at his or her own pace. So if I'm a slow learner, there are many extension points. There are many resources which are available where I can extend my learning. If I'm coming up for a quiz, every time it does not need to be an ungraded assignment where a teacher needs to see for what the student has written, whether the answer should be accepted, how many marks should be allocated. Now the instruction strategy has shifted from ungraded to completely graded and automatic assignments. Earlier, we used to set up our internal assignments or internal markings into an Excel sheet. Add up marks, look for assignments, you know, first do it on a hard copy, then get it onto a software solution. Now everything is automized in the flavor of a gradebook. So in the due course of a semester, whatever activities the student is taking part in, whatever activities the student is conducting, he's taking up certain quizzes, he's looking at certain videos, he's given certain test assignments, submitted open book exams, whatever. All the grades are available in one auto-generated grade sheet. So you just need to download that grade sheet as a summary of your internal assignments. So all these features are present when you use a solution like an LMS. This is known as a flipped classroom strategy, focus being shifted from the facilitator to the learner. Then Moodle in its course was developed in 2002. And was headquartered by a company called Moodle HQ, it's an Australian company, which initially had around about 50 developers. But later on, till date, there are more than 84 Moodle partner servicing companies. 84 companies which have collaborated with Moodle, which provide an extensive user support to the Moodle community, which are most famously known as Moodlers in the terminology. Now, Moodle is an open source solution. It's a software which is written in PHP. So that is why you need to have your XAMPP servers and certain settings which the server will tell you, because Moodle is completely written in PHP. It's open source under the GNU license. So this was the basic introduction or basic know-how of what Moodle is, learning management system, and how can it be used. Let's move further. Now, here are certain statistics detailing the outreach of Moodle globally. So if I talk of Moodle, these statistics have been taken up from the Moodle site, that is moodle.org, and they are continuously updated each time. So across the globe, there are over 1.5 lakh Moodle sites that are functioning, which means 1.5 lakh independent Moodle downloaded solutions, which have been registered. I'm talking of the registered sites with Moodle. I'm not talking of the unregistered count. That may even be greater. So more than 1.5 lakh Moodle sites functioning all across the globe, wherein people have updated their own courses, they've created their own categories and programs, and are running the blended learning model. These 1.5 lakh sites have over 2.5 million courses running under them. So you can think of a Moodle site to be one platform, a college solution, wherein you can run different programs under different categories or departments, and each program has a course of various semesters. So under these sites, there are more than 2.5 million courses which are running currently. The user base of Moodle currently is more than 20 million, one of the world's largest and even way more greater than Google Classroom. Under these 2.5 million courses, there have been over 100,000 enrollments, more than say 100,000 enrollments all over the globe. Students have come registered as students, teachers, course creators, guests, and using the contents which is present on this site. On these sites, there are some forum posts, or you can say certain discussion posts or forums which have been created, and there are many courses which not only have the functionality of discussion posts for the students enrolled, but also for guests. So one implementation of a Moodle site you can think of is the one where you've been giving your test. Most of us would have appeared for a test in the last week on whatever the FTP contents deleted up till that date. That test was conducted on a Moodle site. It was created by the instructor. So you can imagine the flexibility there, how easy it was for you just by logging in your ID password using your credentials, you could take up that test and attempt all the questions. And it is even more easy to create that test. So that is how we'll be telling you in this 1 week, how did we create that test? What went about in creating that test? What were the different options available with us? The heart and core of an asynchronous learning mechanism are the resources. When I say resources, I mean PPTs, slides, videos, URLs, books, all content which I need to provide to supplement my learner to further understand his learning on my subject or on my course comes under the category of resources. So more than 22 million resources have been created on the Moodle sites registered so far. Now, quizzes or online examination is a very sensitive topic when it comes to the blended learning model, because maintaining the integrity of an online examination is very important and is very critical for any learner. For any institute conducting an online examination, there comes a lot of drawbacks, or there comes a lot of gray areas where an institution might think about taking the entire examination process online. We have been doing a lot of online teaching learning since a very long time, but moving examinations online is a big concern in the country till date. Many institutions have adopted the basic pen and paper mode. They have switched to the offline mode, even taken the risk in these times, because they can't trust with an LMS with the integrity of a sensitive component like examinations. But in Moodle, there are many variants available to conduct a sensitive or a completely biased exam, something like we call a safe browser exam. What is a safe browser exam? An examination which allows a student, or say, I'll say disallows a student to use as many resources to cheat. The student can't switch tabs. There are proctored examinations available. Student can't move the window. There is even video monitoring available with these examinations. So this methodology of conducting examinations has been implemented with Moodle since a very long time. There are many options available. We'll be discussing that when we take up activities and examinations, activities and quizzes later on in this week. Moodle's outreach is not just to a few countries, it's to as many countries as 244 across the globe. And it will surprise you that amongst these countries, the countries maximum use Moodle are United States and India. So India is not way far from US when it comes to moon installations. It is just a few thousands or a few hundreds away. So Moodle has been there in India. It has been accepted by many institutions, like we have DOAC or certain training programs of the government. They have been using Moodle since a very, very long time. Many schools, one most famous school is the DPS, Delhi Public School. They use Moodle since a very long time for their implementation and has been very prevalent in the country. So this is the count of the registrations or the registered sites from the 244 countries where Moodle has outreached. Next is the statistics that the user site, user size or the size of registered users in these Moodle sites. So an average of users in a Moodle size site, maximum user size is detailing between 0 to 1000. So an average Moodle site has about 1000 registered users as such. It can vary. So this is a scale. I've shown you a basic tabular representation of the count of users registered with Moodle sites. Moodle is a software coming from 2000. And there have been various software upgradations in Moodle. So the basic stable version earlier was 3.3 when Moodle began its implementation. But till date, the most stable version is 3.9. It's a very recent version. So before 3.9, 3.8 was a very much accepted version worldwide. So this chart shows us how many users or how many Moodle sites are registered with Moodle version 3.8. So if you go on the Moodle site, moodle.org, to download the Moodle package, you will always be given the latest package, the latest stable version. So we'll be working on Moodle 3.9. That will be the latest stable version of Moodle. And all these versions that I'm talking of, 3.9 back till 3.3, have backward compatibility. Okay. So here I'll be discussing certain usage or intended Moodle usage of Moodle as an LMS. First of all, Moodle is very, very largely used as a choice of learning management system in trainings. If you want to conduct trainings in corporates, governments, or even educational sectors, in any sort of these components, we use Moodle as a preferred choice of LMS. Popular trainings like the onboarding training. Onboarding training is one where a person or a candidate is recruited into a company and he or she needs to go through a process of certain training videos when we're talking of certain ethics to be followed at workplace, certain policies that the company follows related to, if it's a software company, then certain development policies, certain plagiarism policies. So set of onboarding trainings can be conducted using Moodle LMS. Student can, or the learner can, go through those trainings. They can also take an assessment as to what was the learning of the joinee apart from taking these trainings, or you can probably just upload the content as resources on Moodle. So onboarding trainings are majorly conducted using Moodle LMS. Then there are compliance training, compliance to certain rules, what procedures are followed in the company. So all these types of trainings are also taken using Moodle LMS. Then competency-based trainings, assessing the skills of an employee, skill competency mapping, assessing certain development programs or improvement programs based on the skill of an employee, like where he's lacking, if he needs to be provided certain grooming or sessions or trainings in communications or leadership or management. So such sort of competency-based trainings can also be taken up using Moodle. Then there are workplace rules and regulation training. If a employee has to go about certain rule-based trainings before getting on board, before the onboarding training completes, these sort of training packages are available with Moodle and they are implemented. I'll be talking of certain scenarios when Moodle was used as an LMS also later on in this PPT. Apart from trainings, the most intended use case, or I'll say the most prevalent use case in Moodle, is the online teaching learning mechanism, also known as the blended learning mechanism. So continued education, earlier online continued education beyond the classroom, but if I talk about now, is this whole soul mode of knowledge delivery or communication. That is, classroom is not being conducted in a physical space. It's now moved everything to a virtual space. So conducting trainings or conducting an education-based sessions, or you can say classes, in an online mode, in a synchronous learning model. That is the main use case of Moodle. Then Moodle is also used for online curriculum development. If you want to develop a curriculum, Moodle can also be supplemented by certain additional functionalities like a mind map, which help in curriculum development. As far as I'm talking of taking synchronous learnings or synchronous classes using Moodle, so Moodle comes in with a very important functionality of something called plugins. So you can think of plugins to be actually extension points to a concept. Moodle provides you certain base functionalities, but if you want certain more functionalities, there are more than hundreds and thousands of plugins which are available free of cost with Moodle. So plugins of softwares or video conferencing tools like Zoom, Microsoft Teams can be integrated with your Moodle site. So the classes that you're taking on Microsoft Teams can be integrated on your Moodle site as well. So you can directly create a team meeting or create a team class using Moodle LMS. This is done using the plugins functionality. We'll be discussing plugins in great detail. We'll be also showing you how to download plugins, how to install plugins. So that is a complete session that we have there. We'll be discussing this component. Next is, apart from curriculum development, it can also be course planning or course development, for which you can use Moodle as a preferred choice of LMS. Online teaching learning model has been sufficing on Moodle as a choice of LMS since a very long time. As we all know, these certification examinations, which come under the online certification examination category, that is the global certifications we are talking about, are conducted using these learning management systems. Either it be an Amazon-based certification or a Google certified trainer, or you can say it can be Microsoft-based certifications, even Oracle certifications. All certification examinations have been conducted so far in an offline mode, and they have been global certifications. So this component has been there, has been prevalent. It is just that we are new to it and we are imbibing to the new space that is right in front of us. The next intended use case of Moodle is the corporate. So Moodle has its applications not only in academics, but also in corporates. If we want to do a product launch, so earlier everything could have been done by visiting the client site. There have been annual meetups where product launches were possible. But this year we've seen companies like even Apple and Google, they are doing their product launch and conducting consecutive trainings using the online mode, everything to the virtual space. So product launches for clients which are not in the same geographical location as that of the developer can be conducted using Moodle. Then certain community initiatives, so corporates have this wing of corporate social responsibility, also known as CSR. So this corporate social responsibility or community initiatives, where a corporate needs to conduct certain social work or activities related to the community, can be conducted using an LMS like Moodle. So earlier there were certain plantation drives and corporates used to visit slum for certain education-based activities or trainings, or you know, empowering the slum children or empowering the girl child. So all these initiatives, learning courses and trainings are now conducted using an LMS like Moodle. Next are product implementations. So if a product-based company needs to develop products and customize it according to its client, you know, this is called the implementation wing. So these implementations can be carried out using an LMS like Moodle. So if I have developed a software and now I want to customize it according to my client's need, whatever my client wants, some client wants a software to be implemented in a different way. Other clients might have different requirements. So whatever the client-based requirement for a product need be, can be conducted using an LMS like Moodle. So product implementation, implementation engineering, and implementation-based trainings can also be conducted for corporates using Moodle. Next are PIP initiatives. PIP is also known as performance improvement planning. PIP programs, or they are known as PIP programs fondly. So like if in a company and an employee is not performing up to the mark, or his performance needs a certain improvement, has a scope of certain improvement, this can be conducted, this sort of a program to enhance his performance before he's shown the pink slip, can be conducted using a software like Moodle. So the employee can be put on a PIP program wherein he has to undergo a set of trainings attempt for certain assessments, and then his performance upgradation will be evaluated whether or not to put the employee back on board, put him to a different product, or probably, you know, give him a pay slip. So these performance improvement programs, are also known as PIP initiatives in the corporate sector, are conducted using LMS. So these were the intended uses or the use cases of Moodle or Moodle LMS. Now here are certain areas or certain examples where I have detailed how Moodle has been used as a learning management system and how people have taken the best advantage of it. First example in this is in a local cafe in Athens during the global pandemic. All its operations were shifted to a virtual experience with a learning management system like Moodle. So, well, this is an interesting one. So, once Corona or COVID-19 hit the world, many businesses, small-scale businesses, were asked to shut down following mandates, measuring as fights against COVID-19. So, there's a small cafe in Kimolia in Athens, that is Greece, that was forced to close its operations. Now, the cafe switched to a complete online-based mode or an online application based upon Moodle LMS, where it supports hundreds of concurrent users with unlimited storage and a dedicated server for video conferencing session. So the cafe shifted all its parties or all its gatherings or even business meetups or coffee chats, which used to be conducted on-premise, to a solution like Moodle. People used to join a synchronous communication channel, synchronous video conferencing channel, and probably conduct all those activities there. So in just 1 month, the Moodle website was able to reach a unique 14,000 visitors for operations on this cafe. So this was the first example of the Moodle outreach. Next is University of Zagreb uses Moodle to support e-learning in over 115 education institutions in Croatia. So since 2007, this University of Zagreb established the e-learning center at SRC with the aim of starting a systematic implementation of e-learning and enhancing the quality of university education. So with Moodle, this university was able to support 117 institutions with a single sign-on access and more than 59,000 enrolled users and 6,500 teachers teaching in close to 12,000 courses. So that was the scale of implementation using Moodle that the university was able to attain in Croatia. Next is New Jersey Department of Education uses Moodle to support educators across the state. So with Moodle by Ething, the e-learning model trainings were accessible and it could be shared with a large network to reduce the need for travel. So the New Jersey Department of Education contacted every teacher or every educator in the state, asking them if they wanted to contribute to the training module across New Jersey plus to many other states in the United States for the implementation on Moodle. Next is the blended learning with Moodle empowered over 3,500 international learners. So language centers were created by the University of Leuven in 1984 with the aim to provide communicative, oral, and interactive approach of language teaching. But since 2005, the university has moved its processes online, and currently it has more than 3,500 international users with staff from international institutions with a structured and flexible learning program under the guidance of expert trainers. So that is the scale of implementation of Moodle for even language-based trainings or certain art trainings, you can call. Next is Moodle empowers educators in Rwanda, East Africa. So in the last decade, East Africa has seen a rapid expansion of basic education with a greater focus on ICT in education and the transition from French to English-based teaching classes. To date, up to a total of 148 primary teachers have completed the continuous professional development program that was developed using Moodle and have started developing lectures and trainings on the current Moodle platform. The last one here is the implementation outreach example of Dulwich College International, who use Moodle for their international audience for delivering certain sessions. So the DCI is one of the most prestigious international school groups worldwide, and it is spread throughout China, Myanmar, Singapore, South Korea, and has used Moodle to deliver courses for some of its college and high school education. Recognized to the need of extending their online learning platform for over 6,000 students across 9 sites. So these examples were some of the Moodle implementations across the globe. As I spoke in India, for an example, before COVID-19 was the DOAC training programs or the DOAC institution using Moodle for conducting certain trainings and implementation. Apart from that, DPS has all its processes implemented using Moodle as an LMS. So this was an example of the use cases where various people use Moodle as a preferred choice of LMS to conduct their operations completely in a virtual space. Moving further, we'll be discussing certain features of Moodle LMS. What features are available with Moodle LMS? How do these features help us in our K-12, kindergarten to 12 education space, as well as in the higher education space? So let's look at the basic features. First and most important feature of Moodle is that it's a free and open source software. It's completely free. There is no licensing cost involved. It's free to download. And it's very, very customizable. It's your site and completely your content. No cost of investment and designed to complete user need. A very highly responsive site can be created using the Moodle LMS. Next is collaborative and individual learning. Moodle fosters the need for collaborative learning among students. So the basic component which will be missing in the virtual space is soft skill training or life skill-based education. Every student is individually sitting at his or her home and just taking up classes, giving assignments, very little interaction with the peers, very little scope of developing or enhancing on life skills. So there are certain options with Moodle where you can provide collaborative or group learning based resources or assignments and ask students to collaborate in a more closer space. So such an emulation in the virtual space has also been catered by Moodle. Next is the Moodle site is very customizable. So everything that comes onto your Moodle site is up to your choice. The landing page for any user, be it an administrator, be it a teacher, be it a course creator or a student, is called a dashboard. It's like a news feed, right? And it's a completely customizable page providing users with the details of their current and upcoming deadlines or what processes or what notifications have been generated by the teacher. Some resource material has been added, some quizzes due. So all these implementations, completely customizable, are present on the Moodle site. So apart from the dashboard, there is a course overview block which allows students and teachers to easily track what is required as an activity and even filter courses. New courses created or new activities added can be visible on the dashboard. So we'll be looking at all of this from a practical aspect also. Next is detailed activity reporting. So you can monitor your learner's progress through Moodle with enhanced completion tracking and personalized learning plans. So Moodle also allows you to have custom implementations, like, okay, if a student has completed learning from a particular resource or a particular section that was uploaded by the teacher, then the student can mark the activity as completed, or after the completion of this activity, after the completion of viewing a particular video that you uploaded as a supplement on online teaching, the student can take up a small quiz just to assess his or her progress. So there is this detailed activity report, which is available in the form of a grade book that keeps getting generated as and when students take up initiative on your Moodle site. Moodle is very secure. All your data in an on-premise implementation is available on your system or on your machine. There is no chance that your data is going over any platform and you need to figure out how to safeguard the data or how to make sure that the data leak is not there. So in an on-premise implementation, that is the biggest advantage. You have complete control over your data. You have complete control over your Moodle site implementations. The only thing is, they need to be a little technical in you need to be a little technical in implementing those functionalities. Next is a detailed documentation, an on-site detailed user and installation documentation with frequently asked questions for troubleshooting are also available with Moodle. So when you will be implementing with Moodle, if at any point in time an error comes, you can simply look up to the Moodle site, moodle.org, which has a section of frequently asked questions. So with an extensive user support community, most of the questions or most of the problems which people face in the installation of Moodle or in the usage of Moodle have been answered by the Moodle community. Also, if there are certain more queries or if you want a one-to-one support, you can write to the support email ID as well. Next is active user community. Being the most popular learning management system, Moodle has millions of users accessing and making the use of Moodle for their online classroom emulation experience. So active user community and forum is available. There are many users, as you've seen, more than 1.5 lakh million sites all over the globe. So many users are there who are using the same software and are sharing their experiences with it. The biggest plus point of Moodle is its rich and free extensive plugin set. So plugin is like an extension point in Moodle. If you want to have an attendance tracker, if you want to conduct online classes, if you want to integrate a video conferencing tool with your Moodle site, or if you want to conduct a safe browser examination, for every feature there are certain plugins available. I'm just giving you two or three features. There are more than 1,000 features for which extension plugins are available free of cost with Moodle. This is the base power of Moodle as a software, Moodle as an LMS. So many other plugins are also available for Google Apps, Microsoft Office 365, Nextcloud, and many more. Easily navigable on all devices. It's not just for the implementation of Moodle. Since we'll be conducting or creating an on-premise installation, you need a system. But once you have created your Moodle site, once you have installed your Moodle site, as a student, as a teacher, you can access that Moodle site from any device. There is no restriction that you need to just access it from only a system. So you can be giving your FDP quizzes from even your phone. It is possible. So you can access it from any devices, any underlying operating system. It's very compliant and there is no restriction. So these were the basics or the basic features available with Moodle as an LMS. These features have been bifurcated in certain heads, under certain heads for education purposes. Like if I talk of Moodle for K-12, for kindergarten to 12th, basic elementary school education, how can Moodle enrich the experience as a learning management system? First is continuous communication. Using Moodle as a preferred choice of LMS, it can be a continuous communication mechanism for the teacher, from the teacher to the student and also to the guardians. Communication can be possible via messaging, forums, notifications, and there can be absolutely no excuse for missing deadlines. If you have added a quiz or added an assignment assessment that a student needs to take up by the end of the week, then it will also flash as a push notification on the mobile. So there is no way the student can say, I missed it or I did not know this was going to happen. Next is working smarter for engaging students with Moodle's collaborative tools and getting feedbacks to enhance your teaching learning. Smarter schoolwork. You need to be very adaptive in teaching learning these days. It is not that we have just selected on one model of teaching. I have thought of, okay, I will only teach through PPTs and, you know, my topic will be very clear. If the learners ask for certain more supplements, if the learners say we are not able to imbibe the concept using just your slides, or for certain subjects which are more mathematical in nature, which require a blackboard in a sense, if a certain feedback is given by the student that, no, this is not clear, we need to, you know, extend this particular concept or extend this topic, you can do it through some other ways as well. You will need to have certain more sessions on a topic. So you need to adapt your teaching process accordingly. You can't just do it as a one-way communication. Your processes need to refine and change according to the student feedback. So for smarter schoolwork, there are many options which are available in Moodle's collaborative tools. Then when I talk of elementary education, it is very important for students to feel rewarded or to feel very accepted or verified when they do certain achievements. So earlier they used to have certain trophies or, you know, incentives which used to be given when a student performs well. But since everything has been shifted to a virtual space, so Moodle also comes with a concept of rewarding success for K-12 education. Like, you can have digital rewards for participation or activity completion, allocating certain stars. Every student profile has certain stars, say 36 stars. Now, one student has done exceptionally well in my test, so he gets like 50 stars more. He's the top ranker. He's a top 5 star students of my class. So certain digital reward-based points, point-based system, where a student feels appreciated for his contribution. Next is, assignments or assessments in the teaching process can be tailored very well using the Moodle LMS, as it assesses formatively or summatively using custom grading scales. So now if I create an assignment, I can attach my own grading scales. I can attach my own rubrics along with the assignment. So if I want to evaluate the student against certain objectives in the outcome-based education, whether those outcomes or objectives have been met or not, I can do that by associating a customized rubric format with my assessments. Then monitoring the progress of a student, everything is online on the LMS. So you can very easily just monitor the progress of one particular student in your course throughout the duration of your course. What was the attendance? What is the attendance record? How many activities did the student complete? What is the score? What does the grade book say? So there is a very powerful analytical component which is attached to Moodle as an LMS for education-based purposes. Moving from elementary education to higher education, along with the features available for basic education model, certain more features for higher education, one of which being a single sign-on facility. So if single sign-on is that facility wherein if you have an account, where if you have a credential, which is already created, you can use that account on various systems. So a single sign-on facility can be available. So if you're integrating, say, suppose a Microsoft Teams plugin for conducting synchronous classes, then you can also connect to Microsoft Teams using the single sign-on facility or using the credentials of your Moodle LMS. So that kind of a functionality is also possible. Continuous education, not just in the classroom, not just in the synchronous mode, but even apart from the classroom. Even apart from the basic interaction that you have with your student, if you want to communicate with the student at his or her own space, students can write you private messages, they can give you emails, they can turn in assignments. Continued communication, you can even download the gradebook at one click and email it to the guardians, what was the progress of the student. All this is possible with Moodle as an LMS. Active learning support of students in the blended learning model. Students are very actively engaged. Not just do they have something at hand, do they have classes going on, but they also have a plan. What is coming up in the next 1 week? So 1 month from now will be your internal examination. And for that, these all topics will be coming in. So if you are familiar with topic one and you want certain more extended study on topic two, you can go about reading the extended resources or extended learning material on topic two. So that kind of an active learning mechanism is also possible with Moodle. Blended learning, Moodle thrives on the concept of blended learning, not just synchronous, but asynchronous model as we discussed. Examinations being a very sensitive component, you can take up examinations right from an ungraded assignment wherein student is turning in files. So like if you're teaching programming and you have certain programming or a language specific files, if you have a .python file, a .py file, or if you have a .java file, or .c file. So these customized file types can also be submitted as assignments. Apart from that, you can have quizzes where you can ask the student to attend certain MCQs. You can also have subjective answers to those MCQs. You can have open book assignments. You can even have safe browser exams wherein you don't allow the student to switch a tab or the exam starts in the form of a full screen slideshow. If a student tries to, you know, press any key apart from the examination, the exam terminates. So all the safe browser examinations are also possible, and this functionality is available with the help of plugins in Moodle. customized grading, as I said, with every assignment, you can attach your own grading scales. So it does not need to be necessarily a 5-point grading. It can be a 7-point scale. It can be a scale in the form of certain alphabets like A grade, O grade, B plus grade. You can also have your customized rubrics mapping to your outcome in an outcome-based education environment, mapping to your course outcomes, basically. So that is also possible. Progress monitoring and digital rewards remain same from that of K-12 education right up till higher education. So these are certain use case and scenarios of Moodle in the higher education space. Now, if I talk of Moodle implementations, as I mentioned right in the beginning, there are two basic type of implementations with Moodle. One is an on-premise implementation, another is a cloud-based hosting. So we will be discussing an on-premise implementation in the course of an FTP. And just to give you a basic know of what a cloud-based offering is, I will tell you how the cloud-based solution works. So an on-premise implementation, as I said, on-premise, within your premise, your Moodle servers are on your desktops or on your laptops or workstations. So you have your server in place. You have your server within your premise or within your campus. So what happens in such kind of an implementation is that in an on-premise implementation, everything is available within your own locality, within your own periphery. So you're very convinced, you're very safeguarded about the fact that your information is not being leaked anywhere apart from your premise. Only thing here is that you need to be a little more technical when it comes to implementation. If there is any problem with the Moodle server or if your Moodle site is down, you need to have the expertise to do a complete run through or a troubleshoot to that problem and turn up your site. Backups, recoveries, everything, every technical aspect of the implementation is to be either managed by you or a technical person within your campus. So this is an on-premise implementation. It's absolutely free of cost. A cloud-based hosting is one where you're using the Moodle site, which is provided by a cloud service provider. So there will be a cloud service provider, like if I talk of Moodle Cloud or Genomio. These are cloud service providers. What do? They conduct the entire process of installation. They take care of everything, all the requirements which are there within the Moodle installation or which requirement set, compatibilities, everything required within the Moodle site and apart from it is taken care by the service provider. And the service provider has set up your entire site. So the process which we will be doing from the next session up till tomorrow morning or up till say, I'll say Friday, all the customizations in the Moodle site and installation have been done by a cloud service provider. For basic implementation, they provide you a free version. It's like free up till some 50 users, or you can have certain other functionalities which are free of cost. But when you increase the size, but when you increase the scale or you ask for certain additional functionalities or plugins, certain functionalities will be paid. Because that is the business model. Nobody will provide you a service if there is no financial component involved in it. And where does the financial component come from if Moodle is an open source system? It comes when the cloud service provider is looking after your technical nitty-gritties, is taking care of your technical implementations and problems. So that is a cloud-based offering where you are relieved of the technical component. Just like you access any Google product, even when we create an email account, we just move to Gmail, fill in a basic form with our details, probably verify an alternate email ID, and we are there with an ID password. That is how your Google Classroom also works. Just put in the single sign-on, same email ID password, same credentials, or create a Google account and access the Google Classroom. Everything is taken care of by the Google Classroom. The site will never be down. Every time you try and access your Google Classroom site, it will always be up and functional. Your data will always be there. But in case of Moodle on-premise implementation, if something goes wrong, if your server is not up and functional, if something is not working, then you have to look after and take care of all that. You have to be technical enough to look after those details. So that is a basic difference between an on-premise and a cloud-based hosting when I talk of Moodle. Now, there are certain installation requirements which will be discussed in the next session onwards. Since Moodle is written in PHP, so you need a XAMPP server, you download certain Moodle package, and basic Windows requirement, basic version requirements in this space. All this will be discussed step by step, the requirements, how you need to download the packages, how you need to go about the installation process. These requirements are essential for an on-premise installation, which we'll be walking you through step by step in the next session. If I talk of a cloud-based offering, there are certain advantages to a cloud-based solution. One is it is simpler. You don't need to take care of the technical details. You just need to go and create your own account on the Moodle Cloud. It's maintenance free. If anything goes wrong or if there is any problem with the server or anything, the cloud service provider is going to take care of things. Moodle is a software, like we saw, it's moving from version 3.3 to version 3.9. It will also be proceeding further. There's a software, so there will always be bug fixes, major enhancements, software releases. So whenever there is a new package which is coming in or there is an update, so the cloud-based offering will automatically update the software. When you talk of an on-premise solution, you have to manually imbibe those updates into your Moodle site. Very flexible. Flexibility is provided in a cloud-based offering by virtue of it being a Moodle cloud-based offering. Since Moodle is flexible, hence its cloud-based offering is also going to be basically flexible with some features added across component. Very user-friendly and affordable. So these are two different variants which are available. As I said, you will be discussing the on-premise version. We'll also be looking at the cloud-based details. And towards the end, I'll also be comparing Moodle with Google Classroom as a very popular choice of LMS. And I'll be giving you a comparison of what both the solutions have to offer. Then it is entirely up to our use case and scenario, what suffices our requirement, which sort of solution will we work with, and we are done with a basic requirement set. So if some people feel that a cloud-based offering is better for their requirement set, they can definitely go in for it. Some people feel, no, technically there are more features available with Moodle and I'll do with an on-premise installation, they can go for it. So that is completely user choice dependent. So just for a little awareness purpose, a slight heads up, I have a small quiz, a Moodle basic quiz, just on the basis of what we've discussed till now. I'll be copying this URL in the chat box. You can access the URL even from your mobile devices, no problem there. It will be directing you to a Google form. I request you to just attempt the questions which are mentioned in the Google form by clicking in this URL. If you are able to access the URL and the form is opening up, please confirm in the chat box. If you are facing any problems, then also please let me know. This is just a quiz for heads up purpose. It is not going to affect any assessment or anything. It is just to enhance your understanding of the concepts which we have discussed till now. I'll be waiting till all of you attend the quiz, then I'll be discussing the answers before we proceed.
I request all the participants to kindly submit the form as soon as possible. Three of you have already confirmed. Thank you so much. Other participants are also requested to kindly submit the form.
We have 9 responses and 20 of us, excluding me. So I'll be waiting. Please submit the quiz.
Only 10 responses received so far, dear participants. I request everybody to kindly attempt the quiz. Thank you, Lalit sir.
I'll wait for the next 5 minutes, then I'll discuss the answers. Please hurry up. Okay. The first question was, what are the main features of a learning management system? You have to select more than one answers, and depending on if you selected all the correct answers, would you be marked correct or plus one? Otherwise, even if you miss just one, it will not mark you for the entire correct answer. So the main features of a learning management system are blended learning, flipped classroom, and online education. So distance learning, the flavor of distance education in an LMS is basically online learning. So there were three correct answers to this question. Next is, which of the following are free learning management system? Moodle and Google Classroom are open source. Canvas and Blackboard are not. They have certain cost component associated with it. And when you talk of Moodle, in that case, an on-premise installation is completely free, but a cloud-based offering has certain costs available for advanced features. So we take Moodle Classroom as a choice for a free LMS also. Moodle is written on which platform? PHP. That's the right answer. Moodle outreach is prevalent in how many countries worldwide? 244. Which of the following is the most stable version of Moodle LMS? It talks of the most current stable version, that is 3.8, but 3.9 is the most widely used and latest version. 3.8 is the most stable one. Which Moodle feature provides extra functionality for learners, teachers, and admins? That is plugins. Which of the following is not a Moodle cloud-based hosting? Alpha, Genomio, Moodle Cloud, and Lambda are cloud-based offerings. Moodle offers you which of the following? It offers a customizable online site, LMS with student engagement options, and a blended learning model. All of them. That's the correct answer. Both. Moodle on-premise is better than Moodle Cloud. It is basically dependent upon your use case. So there is no right or wrong answer to this question. There is no agree or disagree. It's a neutral state. Last one is, Moodle has usage for which of the following sectors? K-12, higher education, and industrial training. Not for e-commerce. So those were the responses to the quiz. Continue. Till now, we have discussed what are the basic functionalities of a learning management system, what comes under the learning management system, features provided with Moodle, different types of Moodle offerings, cloud-based solution and on-premise solution. Now, with Moodle as an LMS, we'll be discussing certain basic functionalities. We'll be delving more into the technical terminology of Moodle, just focusing on Moodle as an LMS. So, first one is a dashboard. So as I mentioned, a dashboard is your landing page. So you first of all install a Moodle server, create a Moodle site. Then the Moodle site can be accessed by certain different kind of user roles, either an administrator or a manager or a course creator or a teacher, student, guest, anything. So for all of the roles, after logging in, after putting in your ID, password, or basic credentials, your first landing page, your first home page to any user account is called a dashboard, right? A dashboard is a completely customizable page for users with details of their progress and upcoming deadlines. It is the center of the course overview block, which allows students and teachers to easily track required activities and filter courses. So a dashboard is basically designed in the form of blocks. So a Moodle block is a basic piece of information. You can take a Moodle block to be the basic piece of information that is displayed on various Moodle pages. So a dashboard board has a set of Moodle blocks, right? So different blocks having different set of information, some blocks catering to upcoming assignments, some blocks catering to notifications generated by teacher activity, some blocks catering to student progress, some blocks wherein a student has updated things to do or his or her next steps. So all that comes in the form of a Moodle block. So Moodle dashboard is comprising of many blocks, many Moodle blocks. And these blocks are always, you can drag drop their positions, you can change their sizes, you can add new blocks, you can remove existing blocks. So this makes a Moodle dashboard very customizable. So if you see, the basic design is in the form of plug and play. A Moodle page having different customizable blocks. You can customize information in your blocks, change the lookout of your dashboard, right? So that is what is a Moodle dashboard, a basic landing page for any user account. Next, as I said, Moodle blocks are basic information carrying pieces on a Moodle page. They are not just present on the dashboard, they might also be present on different other types of pages like post creation, courses, so on and so forth. The purpose is to provide certain information. They are movable, changeable, and they can be added or deleted as per user convenience. User has the flexibility to arrange blocks on his or her own page. Next, there are certain type of user roles or Moodle users, which we will be discussing when we create users and allocate roles to them in the session on Wednesday. But just to give you a brief know what those user roles are, the person who will be setting up the Moodle site, like we'll be doing a on-premise installation, the person who will be setting up the Moodle site or doing the installation part and creating your customizable site, the creator of Moodle installation Moodle process is known as the administrator. He's a super user of the Moodle system. He has the maximum privileges, and an administrator can never be deleted. Once created, at least one user role will always be present on a Moodle site, that is of the administrator. Now, in certain advanced versions, Moodle 2.2 onwards, there was a more defined role which was arising from the admin role, that is called managers. Managers are administrators with certain restricted privileges. A manager can be created, he can be assigned, he can be deleted, and he has certain restricted activity set from that of a Moodle admin. A manager is basically is there to manage a Moodle site. He or she can access courses, modify them, but usually does not participate in courses. So manager has all the privilege of an admin restricted set. Next type of a Moodle role was that of a course creator. As the name suggests, a course creator is intended to create a course, to set up a course or create a course within a category, and then to enroll users in that course or to edit or update information in that course. He or she can also add activities and resources into a course. The main users, or you can say the primary users of a Moodle system, are teachers. Teachers are the ones who will be assigned to a course. A teacher is actually allocated or assigned to one particular course in the legacy role of a teacher, which is further available in a variant called a non-editing teacher role. So Moodle has teachers in two variants, editing teacher role or a non-editing teacher role. So there can be a scenario in your course where you have a teacher who is going to teach the course, and you have a teaching assistant or a lab assistant who is just going to provide certain functionalities or help perform the operations of the main editing teacher role. So this helping or assisting kind of a teacher can be created in a non-editing teacher role. As the name suggests, a non-editing teacher role cannot edit any components or cannot add or remove information in a course. He or she can only browse through information at the teacher level and assist in the processes of a teacher. So the next role is the teacher role. Moving further, Moodle is the main benefiters for a Moodle site are the students. So a student is one who will only participate in a course. Teachers are allocated to a course. They can add or remove materials to the course, set up the Moodle site for the students. So student comes and only accesses the site, accesses what the teacher has uploaded on the site as a resource, as a quiz or an activity, or take part in a synchronous class, like access a video link wherein he or she can be participating in an online class, but cannot modify the content of a course. A course is designed very separately for a student. So all these roles are defined in Moodle. The description can be seen, their access and privileges can be viewed and altered only by the administrator. Administrator is a super user who has maximum privilege over all these roles. Then the next kind of a role is that of a guest. Dear participant, please mute yourself. Someone has unmuted. Dr. Khan, sir, please unmute yourself.
Dr. Raza, thank you, Dr. Raza.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. So the next category or the next type of a Moodle role is that of a guest. So when we say guest, guests are those users who are not registered with a Moodle site, but can access certain content. Certain content is available for guests to be access without having credentials or user ID password. Like I open up a quiz or I open up an assignment for all people who have the link. You can directly access the assignment with the help of the link, or you can access the course as a guest without having to be a registered user. So that is the most, I would say, least editing or the most restrictive role of that of a guest. So these are different user roles. So the initial stepwise process is first we create users and then we allocate roles to users in Moodle. So this is a two-step process which we'll be taking up through practical demonstration on the session Wednesday. Next is course categories. So first of all, when the Moodle administrator or the site administrator sets up the Moodle site, performs the installation and creates a Moodle site, the next step is creating a course. So you can think of courses to be your specializations that you teach or your departments that you teach, and those specializations will be a part of a program. So the program or the broader category is called a Moodle course category. So a course category can be visualized as something to be like a BTech program. So a BTech program is a course category, and within the BTech program there are certain subcategories, like there are certain specializations, BTech from ESE or computer science engineering, or you can say, you know, mechanical engineering, mechanical, these are specializations. So these will be my subcategories or courses. These are my actual courses wherein I'll be adding up resources, adding up, setting up further more details within the subcategories. So category can be visualized to be at that of a program level. Specializations can be visualized to be as courses within those categories. You can also create subcategories within a category, and those subcategories can have courses. So the hierarchy is completely flexible and dependent upon your installation requirement at your campus. Before you create any category, and if you simply just add a course before creating any category, the course is added into a default category which is present always on the Moodle site, known as miscellaneous. So if your course does not belong to any specific category, it will be added inside the miscellaneous category. These can be like free floating courses, or courses which are training programs which your institute is floating for the outside world. Interactions from people all over the globe. You can invite participants who are not a part of your campus. So such kind of courses which do not belong to a category are added inside the default category in Moodle, which is known as the miscellaneous category. Course categories can be created and modified by administrators and course creators and also managers, right? So this is a basic logical distribution of how categories and subcategories. Next are courses. Once you have created a category, actual data or resources that you need to will be to a course. So you are going to teach an MCA course, or you're going to teach a BTech computer science engineering course. That is your actual course where your students will be enrolling in. Your category will be BTech, but what you'll be teaching will be computer science engineering. So within these courses, this is the actual course where your users will be enrolling and will be accessing certain material. These courses are, every course has an assigned or an allocated teacher. There can be even more than one teacher. Moodle supports the concept of co-taught classrooms, where you have two teachers assigned to a course. This type of a scenario you can visualize, like if in an institute there are there's one course which is being taught by in a morning batch and an evening batch, and for both batches there are different teachers. So Moodle site will have just one course, but the course will be co-taught by two teachers, one for the evening batch, one for the morning batch. So the concept of co-taught classrooms is also supported by Moodle. And teachers, once allocated to a course, once assigned to a course, can add or remove content to a course which is visible to the students. Students will be enrolled in a course and they'll be accessing the material which is added by the teacher. That is the concept of Moodle courses. Now, what type of content will the teacher want to add to a course? The heart and core of asynchronous learning mechanism is Moodle resources. So resources in Moodle suffice the basic element of asynchronous learning. Resources are those elements which a student will be accessing asynchronously without the direct involvement of the teacher. teacher can update the resources, create the resources, and make it there present on the Moodle site. And student can later on come and access those resources and learn at his or her own pace. So this is an advantage with a blended or a virtual learning environment, that a student has a flexibility to learn at his or her own pace. If I feel I'm not comfortable with a concept, I can revisit the concept 2 times, 3 times, 10 times. I can study for extended options, extended resources which are available on the Moodle site. I can go for suggested books, extended study material, or even extended online courses, any NPTEL or Swayam course links which the teacher has provided. So all these components are added as resources. We'll be discussing in great detail tomorrow in this session in the second half. I'll be telling you what all different types of resources are present, how can a resource be created and added, and how can a student access that resource. So this resource creation component I'll be taking up tomorrow, where I'll be telling you what is a book resource, file resource, folder, page, URL. So I'll be discussing IMS content package, all these kind of resources in the second half of the session tomorrow in great detail through a practical perspective. Next is the concept of gradebooks. As I said, due to the continuous assessment environment or the continuous customized assessment process in Moodle, Moodle gradebooks are those wherein the complete progress of a student or progress listing of a student can be viewed in the form of a single gradebook at a single platform. So gradebooks are the summary of the student participation in a course. What marks did the student get in assignment one? How much did you score in the first quiz, second quiz? Throughout a semester, whatever internal marking component you need to generate from the assessments can be viewed in the gradebooks. So we'll also be discussing how to access gradebooks, how to download them in different formats. A gradebook can be downloaded as an Excel sheet. It can be downloaded as a CSV file. It can also be downloaded as an XML file for input to other software components. So there are multiple formats in which a gradebook can be downloaded and kept onto your system. So this is also a component we'll be discussing in the practical aspect. I'm just giving you a brief of the terminology that you'll be coming across in the next 5 days, catering to practical implementations with Moodle. Next feature is plugins. As I discussed, they are the heart and core extension point of a Moodle site. Whatever additional functionality you want to add to a Moodle site, you can always download and install a plugin corresponding to that functionality. And using that plugin, you can implement the functionality. So there is an extensible tool set of more than 1,000 plugins available for free of cost download and implementation with your Moodle site. So that will be all for this session from my side. If you have any questions, you can unmute yourself or write in the chat box. I have one question in the chat box.
Participants may kindly unmute and ask their questions in case they have any question.
Okay, so I see one question in the chat box.
Hello, Tanya, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Can I ask?
I saw your question, but you can also detail. I'd like to hear you.
I just want to, like you explained, that in a Moodle, we have an administrator, a course, the person who is going to distribute the course categories, you said. So that is a person like an admin, like if I am a head of the department, I will allot these courses. Okay, this course is going to be taught by this faculty A. The second course is going to be taught by a faculty B. And then the faculty will, himself or herself upload all the documents and manage the code subject by himself or herself.
Yes.
Do I understand it right?
Absolutely, ma'am.
So then if this is, it is just like an, if an institute can have this Moodle system on their server, and then the administrator will allot, okay, this subject is going to be taught by this person in this semester. And then the faculty is going to handle that. If we are going to today, download the Moodle onto our laptops, then how are we going to handle that? We'll be the administrator, we'll be the course for the practice session. We are going to be the course coordinator or the course category or the administrator. That all part will be dealt on by us.
Okay, so I will like to elaborate to this question, ma'am. I got your question. So today we'll be just telling you how to download Moodle, install it from the administrator perspective. So now there are two variants. What you're talking of is that you want to implement it as an at an institute level. So if you want to implement it as a, at an institute level, you have to learn the process first from us and then go on to implement the same process on your college server. And that will further be, you know, you will be the system administrator, or there will be a technical guy along with you who will be handling this process and allocating. Either you be the site administrator or you have somebody working with you at the institute level. But there can also be a scenario like if I as a teacher, I want to use Moodle for my subject or for my implementation, and my college is right now giving the flexibility to every teacher. Okay, you know, have your own solutions for the blended learning model. Then the implementation that you will be doing on your laptop, you will be the administrator and you'll be creating only one course that you teach. But if you want it to be implemented at an institute level, then you have to do it on the college server, college machine. There has to be a machine. Like we have our Moodle implementation at PBI Camp on our college server. We have that implementation. We've hosted it on the cloud network from the college, right? So for that, we have a faculty who is looking after that entire installation. He's the faculty also of one subject, and he's allocating different subjects to different other faculties. You can have a site administrator doing that. You can have a different technical administrative person who's there in your premise, or you can be the same person. But you will need to do that on your college machine. You need to host that Moodle site on your server. So just to make it a little more clear, I'll give it to you in layman terms. Like what the implementation we'll be doing right now. You will do an on-premise implementation at your end, and I have done an on-premise implementation at my end. Now, I cannot share your implementation. It's like we have done some, we've created a program and it is there on our own local machine. For me to access your implementation, if you want to add me as a teacher for a course, and if you want me to access your implementation, then you have to get your implementation, the implementation that you have done, you have to host that implementation on a server, on a cloud server. That can be an AWS account or anything. You have to put it at a platform where I can see it and access it, right? I can't access your system directly. So that kind of implementation will require one more level wherein you host your implementation on a cloud server and I can access that cloud server. It's like a common place and I can simply use your implementation, what you have done. This is how your students will also be accessing. This will be required at the student level also. So we are teaching you the first step here, how to implement Moodle. Then you have to get your implementation to a cloud server so that your students can access it. That is level two. So either you can do everything on your own, or you can have someone, you know, who's more technical, who's going to assist you at the campus level. You can supervise the process because you know the implementation. So these are the two variants which are available. If I have tried to answer your question correctly, if there are any more doubts, you can let me know.
Ma'am.
Hello. Ma'am, your voice is breaking. Hello, Suman ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Certification, like when we are doing on premises work, then how the students will be seeing the materials? What will
that
be
is what ma'am.
If I do using that. The
got it
solely, then how do we do it?
Right. So the same question I like to extend. This is what I'm saying. Whatever on-premise implementation you're doing will be there only on your system. If you want your students to access it, simply you have to move from a private IP to a public IP. You have to bring it to one platform where the world can see it and access it, right? So for that, you have to host your software on a cloud hosting, on a cloud-based environment like AWS. AWS is a server where we host our software applications. I'm just giving you an example. You can create an account.
About how to do it on a cloud.
Yeah, we can discuss that now. Tell you that in the sessions. Uttam sir will give you a brief idea of what I'm talking about, how to get it to your students. So we'll give you a process for that also. But first, what is important is to learn the creation of Moodle. Then only you can get it to the cloud. Then only you can host it on the cloud. It's like cooking something. You need to first have the ingredients and cook it. And then you can place it at a level where others can access it. just to put it very simply. Thank you.
Any other participant who would like to ask a question? Any other participant who would like to ask a question? Well, in that case, I think most of participants, they are actually satisfied with the introduction model. And for introduction, with this, I think we have a journey of learning management system Moodle. So with this, we put an end to today's session. But before ending today's session, I would be thanking ma'am for her wonderful session. And I'm sharing, ma'am, your certificate for this session. I hope it is visible. I hope my certificate I am sharing for ma'am is visible. Ma'am, please accept this certificate from our side. It's a simple token of remembrance from our side for this wonderful session of yours. Thank you so much, Tanya ma'am, for the wonderful session. We look forward to more sessions and more knowledge from your side on Moodle and how to work with that. So thank you so much, ma'am, for this wonderful session.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I can see the certificate. Thank you. And all participants will be with you in the due course of this 1 week. So if you come up with any queries later on as well, most welcome. We are happy to answer that. Next session, 4 p.m. onwards, Uttam sir will be discussing the installation, on-premise installation process. So looking forward to meeting you all in this due course of 1 week. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Dear participants, with this, we'll end this first session and we'll be closing this room. 3:45, we shall be opening this room again for the second session of today, which will be taken by Professor Uttam, as ma'am has already introduced. He shall be starting with how you can download and how you can install Moodle. So that will be the second session of the day. Ma'am will be there with us through this week for other features of Moodle also. I thank you so ma'am for the session, and with this we end the first session of today on introduction to Moodle. So thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you all dear participants. Professor Manish, I think we can close the room for the time being. So thank you so much all of you. We shall be opening the room again at 3:45. So kindly join us by 3:45. Thank you so much. Manish sir, I think we can close the room now. Participants can leave and they may join us back at 3:45. Dr. Kalapala, I am still yet to receive your assignment. Same is true for Dhanke Jyoti Atul ma'am and Lily ma'am, I had already told you.